I'll just introduce myself. My name is Rohit Rathanman. I am part of Agile CV team in Capgemini, and I work at some projects. I'm working as Scrum Master and an Agile coach for one of my clients. I was planning to conduct a Kanban pizza game that required about 1.5 hours, but I got only 1/2 hour. In this session, I'm conducting. There's another meetup next week from place coming up. I'm not advertising them, but I'm conducting a pizza game there for 1.5 hours. Today I only have 30 minutes, so I'll just conduct a small session and I'll try to cover all the core principles of Kanban, which I'm learning at this phase right now. If you have any questions, I can try my best to answer. So I'll quickly. We are not going to run through slide packs or anything. We are going to play a small game which I learned in my recent training about Kanban. And let's get into some teams of seven, and then we can start playing that. And we'll understand how we can use Kanban for development as well. But because Kanban, basically everybody thinks we can use only for operations. We can also use it for development, and that's what we will try to understand how we can do it using we can take some Scrum concepts, mix it with Kanban, have some Scrum Band concepts, and how it can help. And as we progress, we will try to understand what are the core principles of Kanban, how it can help us.
Can
we get you seven? If you can please stand up and create teams of seven people each. Which team is left?
So we have three teams or four teams?
Four teams. Yeah, I gave it only three teams. There's one marker left with me.
I don't want
Okay, so I think you will need a wall. So you can just come up. Get near the wall. Use this post-it, create stages, development stages, like to-do, design, dev, test, and done. Use this post-it. You can use this
on that side
to stick all your 10 requirements that are given to you under to-do. Okay? So as I discussed, the rules.
You can use that one.
Is it clear? Can we create such? Is it visible? You get it, don't worry. Until the time you get the post-it, you divide it. To do, design, dev. I have given you 10 requirements. To do, design, dev.
Both from the left of the box.
So that's not easy. And you can use that. Yes.
Can join this team.
Part of it and stick it all under to do. All the 10 requirements. Pass it on to the other teams as well.
आपने टेस्टिंग के बाद डेल में ज्यादा गैप रखा है
हम ज्यादा टेस्टिंग करते हैं तो बेसिकली व्हाट आई हैव गिवन यू इज 10 रिक्वायरमेंट्स
आप रखो गैप इट्स ओके
शुड यू वांट टू रिलेट टू कैन पास दिस डाउन फॉर इट्स फुल और 10 टेक इट टू टेस्ट एंड व्हाट इज इट टेक 10 काले ना स्लॉट 1 3
नहीं है वी नीड टू
हां
पुट डाउन
पर यहां पे रख लेते
हैं डन डन
नहीं आप इसको पास करो
अच्छा बोलो ये लोग
लाइटिंग को देखो
ये हो गया
तो ये सीरीज
को
सो as we are working on it let's understand the rules of the game as well can I have your attention sure I just got one sorry Pass on 10 of each to everyone. So you have 10 requirements, 5 big stories, 5 small stories. 5 big stories, 5 small stories, each divided into design, dev and testing. Okay? So now, I have just estimated, estimation work has been done for all the stories. So there are about 230 PDs of effort that is there in those requirements that you need to complete. Okay? So there are four teams. What we are going to do is two teams will work on waterfall, traditional approach, two teams will work on agile. And we'll try to see how different this team's behavior on project goes. Okay, so how do we decide it?
Okay, just
Can I get one volunteer from each team? One volunteer, please. Select one person. So, in
your
team,
we are two.
They are your team. Which one? Team 1 is going to follow waterfall, team 3 and 4 is going to follow Kanban. So here it goes, there are 10 requirements, 230 PDs of effort, dice, so each one plays the role of either a developer or a tester, okay? And you know, on an average, if you roll the dice, 6 times you will get about 3.5, okay? So about 230 PDs of effort, one day, each day you can have 3.5 percent days of effort. So, assuming we are going to run a 2-week sprint for Agile and a 10-day project for a waterfall model. So, you will need about 70 members. So, we have 7 in each team, right? So, the team structure now, the second rule. So, the people following the team following waterfall model will have 7 developers, first of all, for first 5 days, next 5 days, 2 developers and 5 testers. That's your team 1 and team 2. That's the resource leveling we will have in the waterfall approach, right? Okay. In Agile, we will have 5 developers and 2 testers across 10 days, okay? So you can name yourself who are your developers, who are your testers. Each day, we are going to roll the dice and tick off the number of effort, number of bubbles in each stage. I have not given any priority to any requirement. So as a team, you need to understand how you can prioritize those requirements. Agile teams can have pair programming, developers can do pair programming. In each stage, testers can help you in design, but that number of testers should not be more than the number of developers. You can't have one developer and two testers in a design phase. Okay? There are some rules for this. These are the rules for Agile team. Okay? And you can do pair programming. Even waterfall team or the traditional approach team can do pair programming. But the main issue the traditional team or traditional approach will have, you'll have to complete 80% of your requirements before you move on to the next stage. Your next stage cannot start till you complete 80% of your requirement. Right? there are some rules for testing defects as well, but as we progress, I'll clear those rules as well. So any questions, how we are going to run it? No? So I'll just give couple of minutes for you guys to decide on the priority which story you will take on the day one. Couple of minutes guys, decide as a team which stories you will do, in which stories you will do pair programming, which one you will start working on day one.
You guys are wonderful. There are 7 developers, all 7 of you are developers. So you will roll your dice once you look at D1. Assign yourself, your D1. Roll your dice, you get 1. So first one, any story, whichever you have picked, one worker. So you are now in depth design. You move into design, master one. All developers, you can master.
Waterfall
way,
how many testers?
5
tests we have.
First 5 days you are going to have 7 developers. First 5 days you are going to have 7 developers, and no testers. In the next 5 days, you will have 5 testers, 2 developers. You will understand? Again, close the dice. Please. Then whatever you decide, if they are pair programming on the same story, you can mark those 3.
5 developers.
No, how many if they are done, you just mark the one. If it is done, the design is done, move it to dev. Okay. But it can, the dev cannot start till your 8 stories are done. Okay. 80% of your work in one stage should be done to start the next stage. Okay. Are you guys here? Are you guys done with your planning? You understood how you are going to do
next
5 days, are you planning? Are you guys done with day one planning? Give dice. Give dice. You only have 3 to 5. You are short by 2 guys,
yeah?
You are not opportunity. So there one less. So
share this.
Share this. Okay, done. Are we done with day one planning?
Yeah,
are we done with day one planning? Any issues? Yes. 10 requirements. Anyone you can pick.
Day one.
One second. Just a minute. Yes.
So for the first time, we have
done this. Hold on. I'll say when you have to start your day one. Don't worry. Just complete your planning. Which stories you have to take. So all the team will run day one together. Don't worry about that. So are we done? Can we start? Can we done? So we are going to start day one. Team one.
Will not be able to clear over 2:30.
Your sprint planning is time box, please 2 minutes only, not more than that. This session is time box. This session is time box, so you will need to do your planning in 2 minutes. Are you guys done?
Can we start with next 2 minutes?
Yeah. Can we start day one execution? There's no lot of planning. You can't do a lot of planning Okay, let's start day one execution. Developers can start rolling the dice and start marking those bubbles. Done. The number of, what you get in the dice, you can mark those bubbles. Done. It will be helpful for you guys to write down the developers who are working on those stories. So you can write down if D1 and D2 are working on a particular story, write it down on those.
Okay.
So, put it at
six bubbles. Max six bubbles.
In design.
Three guys. Okay. Hold on. One rule I have not told you guys. Just a minute. Excuse me. Just a minute. One rule I have not told you guys. If you are rolling a dice and if you are assigned to a story, say design is requires only 3 PDs of effort, you get a 6. You only get to choose 3. You can't pass on the rest of the 3 to another part. Okay? So don't pass on those extra numbers. You have created a flow. You have things in depth, things in design. To do is there. You still not risk testing. Day one done. What about you guys?
Waterfall.
So you are following waterfall. Okay. So you have majority of the stories are in design. You got good scores, I think.
Yes.
What about you? What strategy are you guys following? You can't move to if your waterfall, you can't move to depth is 80% of your stories are designed
there.
These are design done, but you can't start there.
Whatever design has completed, those have been moved to depth.
But you can't start there. You understand that, right?
Waterfall.
Waterfall rule is 80% of your storage, of your backlog should be in one stage. So 80% 8 stories should get design done to start development of those stories. So you can't move to depth if the design is done. That's the waterfall model. And then depth. What about your strategy? Can we hear from them also? Excuse me. 80% what's your strategy?
What was
excuse me, guys. Team, this. Let's hear strategies what other teams are also following.
We have done with the developers and we are working on testing right now.
So you are done with dev for some other stories. So what I can see is rather than creating a flow of stories, dev team can something in design or something in dev. Rather than creating a dev, being agile, you are trying to do a batch flow. You are completing it, whatever you are taking, completing design and moving to dev.
it's just that we have a very smart team which has completed the work on time. And we have been to the dev and we have done test-driven development along with the testers.
So I'll come to those four principles of Kanban where you guys, your strategies are not aligning to Agile or not. So those principles, Kanban principles, I'll come to about, let's run work first week of the sprint and then we'll come to the four principles. Let's run day two, you're planning, complete work in 1 minute, what is your next strategy? Don't start testing her, there's another rule for testing. I'll convey to you when testers start testing, there's another rule.
Excuse me guys, there's one more rule that I'll tell you guys. If you are testing, your testers have started,
it would be in Agile team that they can start testing. If a tester gets a 6 when they are testing it, that's a defect. So no PDs are, you don't deduct the PDs, you create a defect and one developer needs to work on that defect the next day. Okay? And that tester can continue to do the other story. But for that one developer would resolve that defect. Okay? Can we start day 2? Can we start day 2? Day 2 has been started.
They're
participating there short by 1%. That's the freedom for you guys to decide. Team 4 is done with this show. Are we done with day 2 guys?
Just quickly.
Can we see the board? Guys, so now you have to understand what's the difference between your board and their board. And see, there in Agile, if you can see, you are creating a flow. You're creating a flow so that when dev team requires something to start work, the dev design is done. Whereas you see there, your things in waterfall are moving in batches, stage by stage, phase by phase. So you don't have time to, you know, recover when you get start finding issues. Whereas here, you can, the next day you can recover and try to see how something, if you are not, if something is blocked, you can start working on something else. Okay? So can we start with day 3? And then I will start, because the session will be 5 to 10 more minutes left. I will start talking about the code. Now are you guys moving to test? 80% of the dev should be still in dev. Dev actually not yet to test.
Day three done.
Can we quickly start day 4 and after that we'll discuss the core principles of Kanban. So day 4 and then let's see what the last. Can we just grab day 4 quickly? Day 4. We are running day 4.
I'm going to go to the next one. आप नहीं
नहीं मत पांच सही
टाइम
देव में देव
So all team day 4 done. You guys can get back to your seat. I only have 10 minutes. Let's talk about Kanban. Let's understand how the flow. What is the difference between the boards that we had based on the different methodologies that we
followed? Yeah, actually I was lost. Because I was in the lift actually.
So. Guys, okay, just see the difference. Things in Agile have started moving into done stage. You know, there are things that are work in progress in under design, dev, test, so you have a continuous flow. Anything you under development, you say, I'm stuck, I can't move, you have something else to start working on. You know, things like that. You have a difference between a batch and a flow. And many of us, you know, when we study Kanban, we think it can only be used for operations, it can also be used for development also. Okay? Teams who are working on development as well as, you know, they get ad hoc operational issues. How do you work? How can you prioritize it? Things like Kanban board, you know, you can use Kanban system, you can have multiple stream lanes saying these are my new features which I will work on, they are my defects, these are my operational issues, these are my defects for my sprint. You can have different swim lanes, different work in progress for each of those work items. And that's how you can manage your work using Kanban. So there are some core principles of Kanban. The first one says you need to have a visualization of the flow. This is how you will visualize your flow. But when you're trying to set up this Kanban system in your project, in your organization, you will understand you're not only visualizing the workflow. When you are visualizing the workflow, you are seeing the status of the work. But also, by doing this, you are able to visualize the process that you are following. I have just set up three stages of the project, design, development, and testing. You might have more than that. How to identify that? You can write those work items and just try to see how the work items are. You take it to the next person who needs to work on it. And understand from the next person to the next. Understand what is your flow. What are the different stages between in your project that you need to visualize. So as you visualize your workflow, your status of the work, you also visualize the process, you try to optimize that process. Okay. Second core principle of Kanban is to limit work in progress. Many of you, if you see, there are only one in design, three in development, one in testing. There's some concept, you would have heard your manager saying start doing multitasking. And this context switching results in lesser productivity rather than more productivity. There's something called Little's Law. Anybody heard about it?
Yeah.
Little's Law?
Yeah.
So Little's Law says the cycle time is equal to number of work in progress item by number of items that you can complete within a period. Okay? So what is cycle time? What is lead time? In Kanban, we try to manage the lead time. Lead time is the number of days when the work item enters the system and leaves the system. So in this case, from to do to done would be my lead time, average lead time. So in Scrum, you will have velocity, and in Kanban, you will try to manage it with lead time. Okay? But you have different stages as well. So it might not happen one story would get the same time. Enter the stage at the same time. So you can, from the entering the stage and leaving the stage, that's your cycle time. Okay? So my cycle time is dependent on number of work in progress by number of
items that I can complete within that period. So if I say I have 10 items, 10 things that I can work on at one time, and 10 things that I can complete within a day, my cycle time is 1 day. Okay? Just a simple mathematical formula where I try to reduce the number of work in item, and then I can still complete 10 items in a day, right? I'll reduce the cycle time to just half. By just reducing the number of work in items in progress, by limiting work in progress, I'm able to reduce the cycle time. It's mathematically proven. It's not jargons. You can see if you do multitasking, you're not able to your cycle time, your time to complete within the stages will increase. That's how you try to reduce the cycle time and then increase the turnaround. So the flow improves. Reduce parallel working. Third is you need to manage the flow. A second, you see the things are getting blocked, things are in done stage. If I would have in design more than, if I had put three limited work in progress in design, and there are three done in design, and it is not moving to dev, then the work is stuck, right? It is basically a pull system. When you are working in Kanban, you will see people are pulling things, not you are not pushing. When design is done, they are putting it under done, and they're waiting for dev team to pull it, not the design team pushing it. Okay? So when the work in progress limit is done, it is suggested don't take anything extra. So try to understand there is some bottleneck which is not letting the flow to work. So it's a trigger to start your discussion to see where is the bottleneck, how you can remove those bottlenecks. Okay? So that's how you will manage your flow. Those are visual indicators to understand that there is something wrong in the flow. You need to start focusing on those bottlenecks rather than taking up anything new. General idea is there's an impediment. It's a block that I can't move ahead in that story. I'll just put it in the done and I'll take another one there. That's increasing your work in progress. Rather than trying to remove those bottlenecks, you should focus more on removing those bottlenecks and making this flow streamlined. Another concept is, have shorter feedback loop. Kanban, you can have daily stand up, the thing that we were doing. At the start of every day, we had a couple of minutes to discuss in this game, but you can have a stand up. So, your managers, anybody, you can run the board from right to left to understand if my things are done in test, I can pull anything from the dev side and or not. So the boards are run from right to left when you are doing it. Daily stand-up. There's something called a replenish meeting as well, where you can put a work in progress limit for to do. You don't know how much backlog is for you, so you want to have 20 items in your backlog. You want to understand, I can just take 10 items and then keep planning and pulling it out. The product owner realizes as soon as there's some space available in to do, they'll be ready with new prioritized items. So you can have a replenish meeting every week or so. So your product backlog gets replenished to always 10. So your backlog is always, you're maintaining a work in progress there. So these are the policies that you can maintain. Under design, what are the things that you need to pass when you say design is done and you're ready to dev? So these are those policies. This is another concept of Kanban, where you need to make sure that the policies and principles that you have for each stage are explicit to everyone, to every stakeholder. And if you see Kanban board, every team would write those policies and principles within those stages in the board itself. So that whenever somebody comes and sees the board, they know the policies and principles. And there are some different, if you are also managing operations, the way development team might at times get operational issues. So Kanban board provides different work items. You can have expedite work items, which say if you have a board, here itself you can put an expedite work item which will not follow this flow and have a separate. You can put a board, you can put a block here and say whatever ticket is prioritized as expedite will be taken up by the team and that will not follow the normal flow. But you can have a process, you can have a policy saying no more than one expedite a day, a week. Otherwise, every day you will see things to product owner will prioritize and say this is highest priority and put it under the expedite section. So you can have a policy saying only one expedite item a week. So the product owner will think, okay, should I do it now on a Monday or should I put it on a Friday? So So those policies and principles should be explicit to everyone. And then improve collaboratively. Understand those metrics that will help you to determine how you can optimize the process, how you can optimize the flow. Kanban allows you to start as and when how you are working. You don't have to start optimizing the process and say, now we have optimized the process, let's follow Kanban. It's not like that. If you are following any process, put it on the board, visualize how your work is flowing in the system, put it on the board and start working on it and try to understand where is the bottleneck. Start putting this concept of work in progress limit and all and try optimizing it. The more you visualize it, the more you optimize the flow and the process. So that's the Kanban approach for, you know, you can use it for operations, you can use it for development, where, you know, you have a continuous flow of requirements, you can use it for development as well. Okay.
Which is the best tool for Kanban?
Tool as in the electronic tool?
For tracking or tools.
So it is suggested that you have a physical board. Plus, if you have, you will have a distributed team where you might need an electronic board. So there are, you know, there are version one tools like using you have version one Jira, Jira, Microsoft Team Foundation Server.
Which version?
Agile Zen.
No, that's Swift Kanban.
Swift Kanban. So there are a lot of things. Whatever suits you or your organization, how much everything has a license cost to it. So whatever your organization likes to use. So if you have a distributed team, it is suggested that you have volunteers who will update the physical board and as per your electronic board. So if team is working in US and team is working in India and they have the same physical board in US office as well as in India office, and they have you have to update the board as well. So there would be a volunteer to update or synchronize both electronic board and physical board. Physical board is a must to have to visualize it. So as and when you pass through the physical board, you will understand. If there is an impediment, you know, you can put a, some different color sticky and mark it, saying this is an impediment. My SME is not giving me time to understand or not giving me time to for discussion. So it will be reflected. This guy is going to set up a meeting after 2 weeks. Suddenly somebody passes by and says, why is this item going to stay for 2 weeks? That's a bottleneck in the process. So the SME will now, just giving a, you know, example, you can understand your bottlenecks, where are the bottlenecks, is it in the process or not? Okay. You can also start marking, if you have tickets staying in it, blocked in particular stages, you can start marking the number of days like this. Anybody passes by says, what is going wrong with this? About 10 dots. Why is it there for 10 days? If it is an operation, you will have certain SLAs to meet, and those SLAs the ideal time or the lead time will be within those SLAs. The second you are not meeting those lead time, average lead time, your SLAs will not be met in operation, and you will be able to visualize every day these dots are getting increased if it is blocked. And as I pass by the physical board, I would be able to understand it is blocked by something. I would see some sticky added to it mentioning why is this item stuck here. And then somebody will help you, right? The manager, anybody will come up and say, why is this stuck? Because operations is, you know, everybody's priority. So this is how you can manage your work. There are other things. Here I've given you user stories. You can have your post-its where you can mention what you want to track. You can have some electronic ID, some small description, the people who are working on it, a high-level estimate. So things that you want to track, start date, there can be a fixed date work items as well. So you can mention it in the your Kanban card. Kanban basically means signboard, right? Yeah. Everybody knows that. So you can mention your fixed date. So it can have a different color sticky. Saying an orange sticky is a fixed date. As soon as it comes, I need to make sure that my lead time is of 7 days, and the fixed date is about 5 days now, or 8 days. So I need to start working to meet that fixed date. So certain things that can be an indicator. So you need to understand, you need to put your work items like that. You can have a different color for a different color sticky for your user requirement, different color for your operational support issues and all. So how you can visualize that, that will help you to manage your flow, that's what Kanban is all about. And you can have cadence if you want. It's not like a sprint you are running for 2 weeks. It is a flow, right? you can have a cadence as per your team, you know, you can set up own, your own cadencing. After 10 days, we'll try to show whatever we are done with. Something might take more than the lead time, sometimes something might not take as much as the lead time. So you have something as soon as that cadence is there.
So Rich, how do you come up with working progressively?
Yeah. So there is a thumb rule saying if within a stage you are assigned some resources, a design can be done only by two people will concentrate on design and analysis, impact analysis. So the thumb rule is about 1.5 to 2 times the number of resources that you are working on. And it's not a magic number, it has to evolve. As you put some number there, you run for some days and see if it is helping out. If people are sitting idle, that means you need to increase the work in progress. Okay, things are flowing, but the work in progress limit is done. And the next, and one day they are sitting idle. That means the work in progress limit needs to be increased.
Or so is it from the team which comes in, or is it from basically the thumb rule you put in and
you can start with it. It comes from the team. The team can decide how much they can take. Somebody says I can take three things at a time. I can take it. I am a senior guy. I can take it. It's okay. Put it three for now. It's not written on the stone. You can, if you're seeing people sitting idle, you need to increase work in progress. If work is sitting idle, you need to reduce the work in progress. You need to start, that's an empirical process, right? So as soon as you see indicator, visual indicators will show that people are sitting idle, we need to increase work in progress. It's like more of a trigger to start thinking what needs to get changed.
And then how do we, in Needle's Law, how do we come up with this number of items an individual can deliver?
That's what your team has to decide.
So it would be practically there would be a combination of senior and
yes.
junior resources.
That's what the team has to decide. Even a junior can be a better worker than a senior guy. Right? The team collaboratively has to decide on a certain number and see how you're working, how the work flows. If you're stuck, it is an indicator to start looking at, it might not be the right figure at the first go, right? And that's what we need to understand. You can. Thumb rule is about 1.5 to 2 times the number of people in that stage. But if it is not working out, there are work lying idle or people lying idle, you need to start looking into things that you need to change. And that is how you will come to a magic number. But as soon, you know, that's how it will evolve. It is not that the first day you will have that magic number saying this is the correct limit of the work in progress. So you need to put a number and then start working.
Yeah, and that should not be in a particular cadence, your work in progress would be fixed. It's not like that for week 1 you have 10 items work in progress limit, and week 2 you can say my resources are sitting idle, so week 2 we'll take 12. It's not like that. For particular cadence, you have to set one work in progress, that should be there. And if it is not working out, for next cadence you can change it. But that should not be
like it. Physical board itself will show you that things are not moving as you had thought of. You need to start tweaking things here and there and see how it streamlines.
Yes. So we need to work on the bottlenecks and work in progress.
Yes. So that's where you need to focus. How you need to, the managing the flow, streamlining the flow, that's what your target is. By tweaking work in progress, tweaking your bottlenecks or impediments, that's how you will try to streamline the work.
Your roles are same as we have
in Scrum? There's no specified roles. You can continue with project managers, managers, leads, team members, developers, etc. It says you start.
Last question.
Okay. So you can start the next day with the same process. You don't have to optimize the process and then start. That's what Kanban says. Start as you are working now and then optimize as you progress. Any other questions?
Now is something that's called a Scrum. It's a Scrum Kanban. You have the same roles that you have in Scrum, but
yeah. Scrum is basically taking ideas from both Kanban and Scrum. So Kanban doesn't have a cadence defined as like a sprint in Scrum. So you can start having your own, you can borrow ideas from Scrum, have roles like product owner. Kanban doesn't specify any roles and responsibilities. You can have roles like, you know, PO, Scrum team and all. So such type of ideas you can put in, have retrospectives, have Kanban doesn't say you need to have a demo or something, or you know, sprint review. You can have a cadence review in Kanban, say every 10 days whatever is done I will show it to my own stakeholders. So such type of Scrum concepts can be borrowed and put into Kanban, and that's why you combine both Scrum and Kanban and you can call Scrum back. So whatever suits you, whatever best makes you work your project in effectively, you can use that. Last question.
But you know, like Scrum is time box and Kanban is, you can say, work
lead time.
Lead time, right?
Yeah, you run by velocity, you run by ideal time.
Right. How those goes together, like Kanban?
So it's not like, so that, as I said, you have velocity there, you have ideal, lead time here. So you can't have both thing in one. And so things like, as I said, roles and responsibility from Scrum, you can borrow in Kanban. Cadence like sprint, you can have define your own cadence here. Every 10 days, every 15 days, I will have a demo. Demo is not defined in Kanban, it is defined in Scrum, so you can borrow that. Best of both the worlds, combine and then you say you are using Scrum Ban.
Okay. And if suppose it kind of the word that you said, sir, start finishing, stop starting kind of stuff is there, right? So in there itself, if suppose you know in your Scrum cycle that some things are spillover in next week, you can use the visualization technique of Kanban in that so that you can track it properly.
And last question you were asking.
Okay, I just wanted to ask you how we can absorb the risk when it is coming for a flow of operation kind of thing. Usually, Kanban usage it is happening mostly in the manufacturing industry. And definitely, it is linked to software and so on and so forth. Right? But risk, external dependency, and obviously, this is a blocker. If the risk is happening, the information is already not known, then how you absorb it here?
So first thing is, yes, Kanban came from manufacturing, Toyota, right. Toyota started. How you are going to observe, take risk and mitigate it. So as well, when you start working, you start facing those risk and impediments. And that's where, as I said, you need to start putting up indicators saying, these are stuck for these many days. So that's when you get those help from people who needs to remove those impediments. It's more of physical, visible indicators. That's what you need to put on your board. So anybody who passes by, any senior management suddenly sees so many red blocks on one work item. Then it would be an indicator for this guy who needs to jump in. The project manager is not escalating. What is stopping them to escalate? What is stopping?
Stakeholder and this particular main customer, they need to support Kanban.
Any process, if not supported by your stakeholders, will not work. Be it waterfall, be it agile. Nothing will work if the stakeholders are against you.
We are doing it all we do, right?
Stakeholders, if they are against you, nothing will work, right? The requirements will continuously keep changing even in waterfall. Are they helpful? If you're not getting support from your stakeholders, that doesn't mean any. It's like a chaos situation. You can't put any process in such environment.
Thanks.
Okay. Thanks, everyone. If you have any questions.